Okay. Need to call the order, to order the regularly scheduled meeting of the Board of Education for November the 21st of 2017. And Nancy, will you call the roll, please?
Mr. Beavers?
Here.
Dr. Corley?
Here.
Mrs. Dorr?
Here.
Mr. Green?
Here.
Mrs. James?
Here.
Ms. Miller?
Here.
Mr. Lundey?
Here. Pledge of Allegiance. Mrs. Brown, will you lead us?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay. Need to approve the agenda. Mr. Grody, is there any changes?
There's been no changes.
Need to move to approval of the consent agenda, which is the
Let's get a motion.
Oh, I'm sorry. Send a motion in for, to approve the agenda. In a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Sorry about that, Nancy.
That's okay.
Motion carries. Now let's move to the approval of the consent agenda, District 186, regular board meeting minutes dated October 17th, 2017. Tri-County minutes dated October the 11th, 2017. Tri-County bills for November of 2017, applications and reports. Need an approval or need a recommendation for the approval of the consent agenda?
So moved.
In a second?
Second.
Boys. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. District 186 bills for November of 2017. Any questions from the board? And if you have a question, please state the page number for the fellow board members.
I just had a question on the office.
What page?
Well, it's probably going to be an easy question. It's page 3 of the original packet we got. The early childhood 3 to 5 sponsored project. Is that a carry through?
That's the SIU pre-K. So all the funds that we receive from the state board, we pay directly to SIU for early childhood program. And I typically pay that in between schedule as soon as I get it because they've already spent the money and they're just waiting for that reimbursement from the state.
Other questions? Okay, hearing none, I will accept a motion to approve the District 186 bills for November.
I'll make a motion.
Second?
Second.
You're going to roll this, right?
Mrs. Miller?
Yes.
Mrs. Dorr?
Yes.
Dr. Corley?
Yes.
Mr. Green?
Yes.
Mrs. James?
Yes.
Mr. Beavers?
Yeah.
Mr. Lundey?
Yes. Motion carries. Communications.
I have one.
No communications. Fishbowl items, we have a fishbowl, so I'm assuming we have something.
Yes.
Who wants to start? Who's got it?
I can start. This is from Christian Cheryl. Congratulations, Murfreesboro High School has been awarded a Next Gen Personal Finance Gold Standard distinction for your commitment to educating all students in 21st century personal finance skills. This summer, NGPF analyzed 11,000 U.S. high school course websites to measure student access to comprehensive financial education. Murfreesboro High School is one of only 600 high schools nationwide to deliver a gold standard of a required standalone semester personal finance course.
Very good.
We have kind of a summary, I guess, from Lynn Navarro, the athletic director. Congratulations to the 3 student athletes who have earned the right to have their college careers paid for through their involvement in athletics. Despite being outstanding athletes, these 3 have also demonstrated they are remarkable students in the classroom. Drew Stokes will continue her volleyball career at Colorado School of Mines in Golden, Colorado. Mallory Harris will be attending John A. Logan playing volleyball. Brandon Caldwell will play baseball at Lindenwood U in St. Charles, Missouri. We have 18 student athletes that have been recognized by the Southern Illinois River to River as all-conference. Ari Saganovich and Blake Neosporic in cross country. AJ Grammer, Clayton Berger, Jake Attig, Jameer Frazier, Jake Hoppenstedt, Jared Lawrence, Kenny Peterin, Maurice Valiant, Ryan Carg, Zane Caraway in football. In golf, we have Hannah Gahagan and Casey Rendelman. Lily Shaldemose, Rachel Fenders, and Mallory Harris in volleyball, and Drew Stokes in both golf and volleyball. Special recognition as the Gateway section of the Professional Golfers Association of America announces that our golf coach, Jesse Barge, will be inducted into the 2017 PGA Hall of Fame class, which is very impressive.
That's senior, correct?
Yeah. Blake Neosporic advanced from the cross-country regional to the sectional meet. Mike Lane and the volleyball team won their third consecutive regional championship. The season ended with a loss to the eventual state champion and private school, Belleville Altoff. Emphasis on private school. This is the 10th time Coach Lane has won a regional title and the 4th time being eliminated by the state champion. Also, we want to give special recognition to Danny Gould, the Murfreesboro Junior Football founder. He was presented the Rust Breeding Community Service Award last Tuesday night at the City Council meeting. Finally, we also want to recognize Keith Jones and the girls' basketball team on winning the DuCoin tournament this past weekend. This was the 6th straight year for winning and the 9th time since 2003. Special recognition goes to Ari Saganovich, Ashley Jarrett, and Kayla Walker for making all-tournament, and for Kayla being named MVP for the 2nd year in a row. Lynn sums it up, this is an exciting team to watch.
Very good. Congratulations to all of them.
This is from Bill Hubert. Crothers recognized first quarter students for high honors, and perfect attendance on October 27th. The fourth grade placed American flags on grave sites at City Cemetery for veterans. The fifth grade did a great job with the veterans concert on November 7th. And Crothers hosted the annual veterans breakfast on November 13th. Students from all three grades decorated the building and made banners, and the third grade faculty decorated the trophy case for the month honoring our veterans.
Anybody else? I would like to say just one thing. I attended the Madrigal this year for the first time ever. What a phenomenal presentation. For any of you students that are here, if you raise your hands, thank you very much. That was amazing.
It was amazing.
That's all you can say. Just amazing.
I missed it this year, but it's
it was something. So if you didn't make it, you missed it. Okay, Freedom of Information Act requests. We have a couple.
We had a couple. Illinois Leaks, which is American Watchdogs, requested information pertaining to debt of district payments, structure for debt, superintendent compensation contract, and agenda minutes showing approval of superintendent contract. And if that sounds like the same FOIA request we had last month, it is. They sent it again. We sent them the information again. I'm hoping not to get it next month.
We'll see.
And then we also got one from Matt Johansson, who's the IAA representative, just asking about our job description and salary schedule for our head custodian, our district foreman. So we sent that off to Mr. Johansson.
Thank you. Okay, it's time to recognize the audience. The Board of Education welcomes the audience to make public or employee comments. The board has set aside time in the agenda specifically for this purpose. Pursuant to Board Policy 2.230, each speaker will be limited to a 5-minute presentation. Please be aware that while this is the time for the public to express its opinions and or concerns, the board may or may not comment regarding public presentations. If a matter of public comment warrants discussion or action of the Board of Education, such discussion or action will be added to the agenda of a future meeting. Do we have any public concerns or comments? Yes, ma'am.
Yes, I have a concern.
Can you come up forward? We're recording this as well.
Hi.
Can you state your name too?
My name is Jamie Hubert.
Okay.
I have a concern with the math department and the math curriculum at the high school. I'm concerned about the number of students that are not passing math, that have failing grades. I am an educator myself and a special educator, and there are several alarming concerns there, just basically starting with the instruction that the students are receiving daily within the classrooms. If the students are not getting it, they have extra time during ELP or tutoring. There is a high number of students that are needing to go to ELP at the end of the day, to where there's a large number in the classroom, to where they cannot get help during that time. There's tutoring offered before school and after school, and again, there's a large number, so that points concern to the daily instruction that the students are receiving. If it's quality instruction that the students are receiving, there should not be that many students needing help, that extra help during the ELP or the tutoring. Another concern of no textbooks for the math curriculum. The grading policy of the math department is different from the other departments within the high school. There's a lack of daily grades taken, or overall grades taken. The majority of their grades, 80% of that, comes from the test. And there's an issue with that because a large number of students are not the greatest test takers. So 80% of that grade comes from the test that they take. There is a small number of grades that are taken within, but it's not weighted enough to make a big difference how the students do on that. So the homework, there's not like a daily check on that or a binder check to help with the students that struggle with the test grades. I feel like it's setting the students up for failure if they don't fit in the box, if they're not understanding that instruction during the day. Individual students, I feel, are not being met. Why wait for a student to get an IEP or a 504? Again, I know the way around it. I could get my child a 504 just by going to the doctor to get diagnosed as ADD or ADHD for those accommodations to be made. But accommodations can be made for all of our children under the RTI. There's a number of students, if you look into, and this isn't anything new, high number of students that have to go to rebound to get math credits for not passing the math classes, and then just to come back and have to take the same math class over after they receive the credit at rebound. It's alarming when your child has all A's, straight A's, or a B, and then the one F in math. Again, this isn't new. This isn't our first time through this. It's not the first concern we've heard from other parents, also within other faculty members within the school. I've talked to the math teacher, talked to the counselor. The counselor said there are people on board trying to get that math policy changed to be able to help the students that are struggling. I had one child go through it, had to go through the rebound experience. I prefer not to have another child to have to go through that experience, and I am just expressing concerns to try to get some changes made to help the children before we lose more.
Quick question.
Yes.
You said you talked with the teachers and the counselor. Have you talked with Mr. Wilson?
No, I attempted to call, and I tried to call today as well, and he was out of the building.
Can you do that?
Yes.
Please?
Yes, absolutely. So I just wanted to express, it's a big concern, and like I said, it's not anything new. That it's been going on, and we're losing too many children due to this.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate that. Anyone else from the public? About employees? Mrs. Brown.
Yes. Hello. I'm Mrs. Brown, fifth grade teacher. I have a letter to share with you from my fellow fifth grade team. It's in regard to class size at the fifth grade level. The fifth grade teachers are concerned about the impact of the large class sizes on student learning. These large classes are making it difficult and impossible to meet the needs of our diverse student population. Class size also is impacting our ability to plan small group instruction and individualized lessons, which are both key to learning. For three consecutive years, there have only been 5 sections of fifth grade, while other grade levels have 6 or 7 sections. Each year, the number of students per fifth grade classroom average around 28 students, which is much higher than all the other classroom sizes in elementary and higher than most classes in middle school and high school. As a group, the fifth grade teachers recognize that there's been difficult decisions made due to the budget. However, in the past 2 years, additional teachers have been hired to lower class sizes in other grades, and nothing has been done to address the urgent problem in fifth grade. The inequity in class size is obvious and is impacting our students. We voiced our concerns the last 2 years and are now formally asking for you to commit to hiring an additional fifth grade teacher. If this isn't possible this school year, which we would really like it to be this school year, but we are getting halfway through it, we are asking that you hire an aide to help us with this. It's really difficult to watch our students suffer every day because we are not able to do what we know we need to be able to do with our students. So I appreciate, and the letter's signed by myself, Elizabeth Brown, Butch Brazel, Kelly Mahoney, Carmen Woodward, Ashley James, Beth Collins, Jan Luking, and Heather Parr. So I would like to ask your consideration for this matter. It's been a very difficult 3 years with the very large classes. And in some of my classes, like when we have push-in, I'm having 30 or more. We have to make all kinds of adjustments to keep our science classes at 30. So.
What I can say to you is Mr. Grody has already started to have that conversation.
I'm pleased to hear that.
He's broached that subject already, so
Right.
We appreciate the concern.
Okay, thank you for your time.
Any other employees? Ms. Pearson.
I'm Lynn Pearson. I'm a social worker at General John A. Logan. I'll make it quick. I just wanted to let you all know that you may or may not know that every year the social workers in the four buildings help provide Christmas help to about somewhere between 200 and 300 kids, mostly at the elementary school level. We do that by coordinating a variety of programs that run throughout the community, like matching up families with the right programs. And then we also do angel trees within our own buildings. The two elementary schools do angel trees within our own buildings. Again, we focus on our elementary school kids, but if it's a kid that also has a sibling in middle school or high school, we try and cover everybody in the family. We don't attempt to do, we're not trying to buy every kid an Xbox. We're trying to do about three or four wants and three or four needs with a total budget of about $75 per kid. So it's not providing an entire Christmas for anybody, but it is hopefully supplementing a little bit of Christmas, or at least making sure that nobody at our school is going without anything under the tree on Christmas morning. So the reason I'm telling you all this is that in both of our buildings, our angel trees are up. A lot of our staff members, our teachers, and a lot of our parents adopt one or two kids per year, and I'm just making the invitation to the board that if that's something that you guys would be interested in, I would be more than happy to give you all a name. Thanks.
Thank you, Ms. Pearson. Any other employees? All right, thank you. Moving into old business, a district financial update. This is informational. Mr. Grody, I'm assuming that's going to be you.
That is going to be me. I've been telling you that November is the month that we have been told we will be told what our additional revenue will be from the evidence-based funding model. I can tell you that this week I was proud to get an email stating that they're finally reconciling the student data, and we were able to check the student data, and so I'm hoping that before the new year we might have an actual number. We haven't gotten that number yet. You haven't gotten a number yet.
I'm here in January.
You're here in January.
I get a number, but again.
Which year?
Yeah, I know.
So right now, I mean, I'm going to keep this on the agenda because I think we all want to know what the evidence-based funding model will bring us. But the fact of the matter is that the state's got to have the money to be able to pay us. And so whatever their income is, I know that they borrowed from the corporate personal property replacement tax to pay off $100 million of bills. We're going to lose how much from that?
$37,000 to $40,000.
So that's our district finances as they are right now.
Any questions from the board? Thank you. Construction update, informational as well. I'm going to assume that you're going to handle
construction's been going great. The concrete's getting poured. I would imagine they're going to tear into the office building pretty soon. The inside of the office is pretty much gutted. They've gotten in there and they just have to break through that wall. So you can kind of really start to see from where the foundation is, the output of the, they've dug the hole for the seats.
Yeah.
Because the stage is at grade. And so they've dug the hole for the seats and everything like that. Do you have anything you want to add, Mr. Seifert?
No, it looks like they're going to tear into the office next week. next week. And try to get that area going, because right now they're waiting on the concrete panels. They won't be here till February. So it's going to look like not much is going on, and all of a sudden it's going to look like a lot is going on, so.
The abatement happens in the office next week, the asbestos abatement.
Oh, yeah.
For the floor tile and mastic happens next week.
Right.
So a lot of little details are getting cleaned up and getting done, but it's exciting to see it coming to fruition.
Any questions from the board?
Yes. What were the signage requirements for the construction site? I've noticed the enter here sign spray painted on plywood.
Yeah.
And wondering if we could have a better sign.
I'm going to talk to the contractor about that.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
We'll get a nicer sign. The requirements, though, they were happy with what we had.
Well, along those same lines, I mean, I noticed it on the Madrigal and basketballs here. It's so dark along those wooden little sheets.
You want to speak to that about the lighting? Because there's been some emails.
Yes. I'll stand up. When they tore into the power to take all the office out, the lights for that area were on that. Had a conversation with them today. They're going to try to get that back up and running ASAP.
Okay. So I just worry about everybody's pouring in
that
gym now.
We're talking about it being dark.
Yeah.
And so those lights need to be.
We're getting it rolling.
Okay.
So hopefully in the next couple of days it'll be taken care of.
Yep, and going. Okay.
Burke's going to handle that, right?
Yes.
Other questions? Okay, moving to the adoption of the tax levy. Mrs. Bush?
First of all, let me apologize to the board because we did talk about abating half of the county facility property taxes. I got a little excited today with the amount. So we did talk about half, and that is what we will talk about at the January.
Okay.
So I apologize for that. Like I said, I get a little overzealous sometimes, and that was a part of that. But that being said, it would be the administrator's recommendation to adopt the tax levy, the $7.4 million that we place at the October board meeting. With the bond and interest assessed by the county clerk, with a total levy of $7,890,172.
Any questions from the board? Comments? Hearing none, I would entertain a motion to accept the recommendation from administration.
So moved.
Second.
You have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Nay.
Motion carries. The approval of the switch gear bids. Who's going to take this?
I will be passing around the documents. We had four companies put in the bid for the switch gear equipment. That is the big box of panels with a lot of switches on it that the transformer feeds, so that it then feeds all of the fuse boxes in your house. So in your house, your electricity goes right into your fuse box. We have more power going into the switch gear, which then gets fed to all of our panels. That was going to be replaced when we did the auditorium. This is like the phase two of that bigger project. You can see from the bid, with the alternate one and alternate two, Brown Electric is the lowest bidder at $348,303. The high bidder was $385,500. So really, I mean, they were... all of the bids were really close. We believe that this is a responsible bid, and we would recommend that Brown Electric be awarded the base bid plus the two alternates.
Mr. Siegert, have you had dealings with them in the past?
Very many. All four of the contractors.
Yeah.
All four of the contractors were reputable.
Good.
We'd be okay with any one of the four.
Very good. Thank you. Any other questions from the board?
It's not a question. I guess it's just a statement. I'm sure we all feel the same way. I would love to be a local supporter. I guess I just kind of feel bad that our locals didn't have the lowest bid to do that, because we have
join
to
the legislatures and change the laws.
Yeah, I mean, we have to do what's fiscally responsible, but I want to support the locals.
I saw a local contractor lose out on a new sewer plant by like $50,000. It was a ridiculously low amount of money. It was sickening, but it is what it is.
You know.
It is law.
And tell me again, why did these come in so much lower than we expected?
And
what?
I read it.
You want me to talk about
sure. You were the one that gave us the estimate, so
Well, when we put the estimate together, it's at the beginning, we talked to the companies that supply this switchgear. They gave us a number on what the material costs, and then we run our numbers through Means, RS Means. It's a program. The bids came in for the switchgear half of what they told us. So, in turn, the labor cost was down as well, so. We fully expected it to be somewhere in that $650 to $750 range.
Because I guess you had a different idea about the prices of materials?
Yeah, the materials.
Okay.
Yeah.
Your $650 to $750 included how much for materials, roughly?
The material for the switchgear was in that $350,000 to $400,000 range, about what we got for the bid.
And the bid said what the materials had to be to use?
Yes.
I assume there's specs, so they have to follow.
Yeah, we had four manufacturers, are all GE, Siemens, all the big companies. So.
It's good news, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's good news. It makes me feel bad, because we missed it.
We got the similar savings with the auditorium, with the soundproofing materials.
Correct.
We had a higher price estimated, and they came in and gave the contractors a lower price, so.
Yeah.
Can we put the additional rooms on them?
You're like, you don't know what I'm talking about.
I will look
Any other questions from the board? Other questions? All right, hearing none, then I would accept or entertain a motion to approve Brown Electric for the switchgear replacement bid.
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
Nancy, would you roll that, please?
I will. Mr. Green?
Yes.
Dr. Corley?
Yes.
Mrs. Dorr?
Yes.
Mrs. James?
Yes.
Mrs. Miller?
Yes.
Mr. Beavers?
Yes.
Mr. Runge?
Yes. Motion carries. Naming of the district facilities.
We talked about this last month. This would be the second reading. I made the changes that were recommended under the procedures. Instead of having 6 members on the committee that the president would elect, it'd be 7 members. I included an administrator from the building being affected into that group. I also, and under procedures, the president of the Board of Education, any recommendations or desires to remove the name will follow the same procedures for reversal. The president of the Board of Education will name another 7-member committee to describe above to forward the recommendation to the Board of Education for final approval. So basically what I'm saying is if something happens and we want to remove the name because something happens, a committee could be formed, and they would make the same study of the situation and then bring the recommendation to the board for your final approval. And I think the other change was payments of the donations will be managed by the superintendent or his, her designee, which would be Mrs. Bush, this specific time and place.
Got it.
So, yeah, this is the second reading of this board policy, and I would recommend that we approve it as presented.
Questions, comments from the board? All right, hearing none, you've heard the recommendation. I will entertain a motion to approve. Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Before we move into new business, I just have a quick question for Mrs. Ellers. Since we raised the pay of the subs last month, you thought that that would improve the quality of the subs you were getting? Did it, or is it too early?
Yeah, no, we've had some that have said they're coming here because of the higher pay now.
Good.
So. Mr. Keener reported the same at the middle school.
On that note, I saw something that a bill was put forward or something that we would have to start for people that take the exam or get the certificate to be a certified sub, we would have to start reimbursing that. Do you know anything about that?
I do not.
I've read it, but it didn't have. For some reason, it seemed like it didn't have anything to do with it.
It hasn't passed yet.
It's supposed to be allowed, but it's not required.
I didn't remember
paid
that. The
district.
The district.
Yeah, but they go to all districts.
Yeah, they get
yeah,
well,
but it was
the district.
The first one to employ them.
First.
So it'll be first.
I thought I read it May, not that it's shadow, so it's like allowing the district
mm-hmm.
to reimburse it. If I remember
okay.
reading it right.
I'll
look
at
it.
I'll
try to find it. Do you need it now?
No, I don't need it now. Can
but just something
send it to
me remember.
Yeah.
Well, the bottom line is it's improved the quality of our subs here, so that's the most important thing. So thank you to both of you for letting us know that. All right, moving to new business, the middle school elevator project.
This is the next big one that really needs to get done. The current elevator at the middle school, if I had a broken leg, I'd probably try and crawl up the stairs instead of getting into the... to the device. It's just it's old. It's needs to be replaced. And so what we would like to do is get permission to work with our architects with the Attenda award of contract late winter, early spring, so the work can be done this summer. Mr. Seifert can answer all of your questions.
Are there any from the board? How long would that take, roughly? Any idea?
We could probably get the, we're looking at getting it out to bid in January, February. Take a couple months to get the elevator itself. They can do that in 2 months. Probably 2 months.
Okay.
Plan is to put it in by the cafeteria where
if
that landing is you come in.
If we get permission.
Oh, not in the current location.
No. If we get permission to put this in, what we would want is to have it at,
well,
right now the current location.
Get to the cafeteria.
You can't, they have to go outside and around the building and all this other stuff. So what the idea is that it, where you walk in on the cafeteria and you see that white wall in
right.
front of you and you've
right.
got the stairs going up, that would be a door that you could walk into, an elevator door, and you could go down a little bit to get out to the bottom floor, or you could go up to get to the main floor, or you could go up to get to the third floor. That location still needs to be further studied because that does cut into the classrooms that's on the bottom and the top, and we've looked at various ways to solve that, but the middle school is hurting for classrooms right now. They've got a lot of full rooms. But again, once we get the permission to work on that thing, that would be the best location for it because it brings the elevator to the front of the building. You can get to every floor of the building then without having to go outside.
And how much is that? What's the rough estimate of cost?
Understand this is going to be high because the elevator is probably getting bid. I'm just kidding.
$400,000 to $500,000. It's a lot of it just depends. I mean, depends on the type of elevator you go with. If it's a single user, if it's a actual large 8-people elevator, 8-person elevator. So it just, I'm going to give you a high number just because.
Mr. Keener?
Maybe it's not my place, but I'm going to ask that at some point we consider possibly with that project putting in a covered awning that would go from near the street to the elevator entrance for various reasons.
The drop off is.
Mm-hmm.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Like
it's
a tunnel kind of awning that.
Yes. So, I mean, for the folks that obviously would need the elevator if it's raining, that sort of thing, but at dismissal time when it storms, we're in a pretty bad spot there, because if people were able to just drive their car up and then we have a storm and we're dismissing, we could dismiss out that end.
Ideally, that'd be the good place to drop off people that need the elevator, and for, I mean, if we
yes.
could add some handicap parking
folks
over there as well, would be nice.
Presses, you know, that's really handy.
So.
That's a great comment.
But right now, all of these great ideas and this dreaming of making all of our facilities better, we need a permission to work with the architects.
I have one more question.
Ah,
what's going to happen to the space where the current elevator is?
The elevator will be tore out. At this point, that's all I can tell you because
okay.
we don't know. The space is not very big in
no.
any of those.
Three mini. Almost storage closets, possibly for supplies.
Just curious.
Storage or something,
yeah,
or
yeah.
storage for the school would be about all you could use it for.
Okay.
Yeah.
Possibly a tutoring room. I mean, it's not out of the question.
A dungeon.
So your recommendation to the board is to move forward
and work with the architects on
working
the
with the architect
project.
The elevator project at the middle school.
Yes, sir.
I have one more question, though.
Okay.
I guess. What would be, so I guess my concern would be putting money into an old building rather than maybe looking forward and building a new junior high. Like, what would the timeline be?
Unless you're going to raise the building and completely gut it.
I don't necessarily mean it would have to be in that
same
location.
Honestly, even given the timeline, we would still need those elevators in that building. I mean, it's a need. It's an ADA concern at this point. But,
no, I get that. I guess I'm questioning, you know, if we're $500,000. You know,
there's a $500,000. Could it be $250,000, $300,000 for a short term solution versus a $500,000 for a long term?
And then have
solution.
A plan to build a new junior high.
What's the timeline right now for the facility study, Mr. Seifert?
We should have a feasibility study to you for your review next month.
Next month, December.
Yeah.
So in early January, I can meet with the facility committee and start looking at the larger building things. My concern is that to be a lot of, I don't know, I don't want to wait on the elevator.
Oh, I'm not saying wait on. I mean, I completely, I understand ADA requirements, and I'm just saying maybe not.
Get the deluxe model.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
I think anytime you're making a change to a building, like you're saying, having the full picture, the 10-year, 20-year picture, makes you make better decisions than saying, hey, let's do it.
No, I agree with that. And I guess what this board is going to need to wrestle with is building is over 100 years old. And I say that with the sense of pride that's a historical building. It's what a lot of people in this community call the crown jewel. And when I first came here, we were talking about possibly tearing down Logan School.
Lincoln's already.
Yeah, Logan. Logan's the one on 14th Street.
Logan.
And we ended up selling it to Dr. Van Acker. You know, I would think there'd be strong opposition for tearing down that building. And so whatever that building's going to be, I think it's going to need a good elevator in it and a properly designed elevator. So, I mean, I get what you're saying about the cost analysis of it, though, but I just don't see us exiting the middle school or not having it as part of the community in the future. So, but we can look into a cheaper elevator as well.
I don't think you and I either are saying that. I'm just saying if the long-term, if we look at feasibility, and feasibility is this, you know, this school gets demolished, this school gets built, these kids move from here to there, this school gets added on to, whatever the route is for the next 20 years can curtail exactly what we're going to do with this elevator.
Right. I mean, if there's a plan, okay, do we think we might have a new junior high in 5 years? Well, then maybe we know that we can spend $300,000 or $400,000 on an elevator. If it's going to be 10 years before we can get a new junior high, then maybe we get the deluxe model. Mm-hmm. But it would be nice to have a plan.
Okay.
Because this is money that, you know, we...
The conversation has to start. I think it has started. He heard me say it today. I have a tough time spending money on some other issues. When I walk into the library at the middle school in the dead of winter and it's 0 degrees outside and the air conditioner is on because it's so hot above the boilers, that's wrong. I agree 100%. We're starting the conversation. We have to.
Right.
We have to. So.
And so I completely understand what you guys are saying. I still need permission to move forward to go with either the cheaper plan or the more expensive plan. So the recommendation is still to let us work with the architects.
Can we get an option on that when it's bid?
Yeah.
Every time the feasibility study comes all together, you guys might know more than we could go one way or the other.
The concern is I don't know how quickly a feasibility study actually comes to a plan. And the elevator, I know we want to do over the summer. Mm-hmm. So
when it comes to multi-million dollar buildings, a couple hundred grand isn't really going to make a difference here.
a teacher or something, so.
Okay, so you've heard the recommendation from administration. I will entertain a motion unless there's other questions to move forward with working with the architects on the middle school elevator.
And I would say that from what Ms. Dorr just said, though, I want to make the idea for me would be that we are going to bond and try and use some of the county facility sales tax and our cash flow analysis that we did to pay for the elevator. So the elevator project's not taking away from any teachers that we could be adding. So I just want that to be said so that my fifth grade teacher doesn't. She almost killed me the other day.
And that money
I just want that. No, it can only be used for facilities.
It can only be used for facilities.
Yeah, so I wanted to just make sure that that's perfectly clear. The elevator's not stopping you from getting your teacher, Ms. Brown.
That's all that can be spent. Facilities.
Facilities.
Yeah, that's why it can only go to building.
That's the passing of the county facility sales tax.
Any other questions? I think Mrs. Miller was ready to make a motion.
Yes.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. The electric supply renewal approval of contract, which is enclosure number one.
Well, let's skip the enclosure and go to the handouts,
right,
because we have the newest and best information from affordable gas and electric at your place with lower rates even. Currently, we're paying per kilowatt hour 5.776, and the best rates that we received that Mr. Wallace provided us with from Affordable Gas and Electric were with, and basically we have six different companies that have provided rates. AEP Energy is the lowest rate, the lowest of the set of rates. Kind of looking, it's hard to know how far to go out with a crystal ball. Do we go 4 years out? Because what we have now, we're looking, gosh, we're paying 5.776, and look how the rates are now, because I know it fluctuates so much. I really hesitate to go out further than 24 months in the 2 years. Going with AEP Energy over the 2 years would still save us $97,753, assuming we're using the same annual kilowatts over that two-year period without... Because as we go further out, our rate isn't quite as good, but I don't really want to just do a one-year commitment. So that would be my recommendation to the board, that we contract with AEP Energy for a 24-month period through January 2020.
What's the lowest rate you have seen?
Well, this is what I've seen. I didn't get a quote from IEC. They weren't able to get the information.
I mean, over the years, you said you're at 5.
Oh, gosh.
I mean, is this lower than what you've seen in the last?
In a while.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, we did, I believe, Bruce, and correct me if I'm wrong, the rates that we received when we first contracted were much lower than what we originally had with IEC. And I'm trying to remember the last time we renewed, if we got a significant decrease or the rates were kind of up that year. I just cannot remember.
They were down, but yes. You did significantly save over IEC.
Yeah. But there's a lot more competition than there used to be. You know, the first...
That's correct.
It used to be IEC, and it is NextEra Energy, I think, that's
NextEra Energy is who is the supplier for...
Right.
IEC.
They were originally with school co-ops. They were the only game in town when deregulation hit. And now there's much more competition, so you know we have an opportunity to take advantage of much lower rates than what we've ever seen before.
And to clarify, you know, we are a broker, so we deal with all of these suppliers, so we were able to bring all these supplier prices to you, and there will always be a best price. In this case, for all terms that we quoted were AEP Energy was the lowest. And it's significantly lower than where it is now. You see that, Jan said, there's, you can save over, at a two-year term, almost $100,000 over what your current pricing would be at the 5.7.
Good. Questions from the board?
And I would also ask that the board give me the authority to sign off on those contracts, because we have to bind that pretty quickly to get those rates.
Okay. You've heard Heard the recommendation then from Mrs. Bush about AEP Energy. I would entertain a motion to approve that. In a second.
A second.
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Beavers?
Yes.
Mrs. Dorr?
Yes.
Mr. Green?
Yes.
Mrs. James?
Yes.
Mrs. Miller?
Yes.
Dr. Corley?
Yes.
Mr. Rungy?
Yes, motion carries. Item number three, dress code policy. This is informational.
We've been talking about the dress code policy. Policy does a first reading, then a second reading, and then gets approved. We met, and we've decided that the policy we currently have can stay the same. What we need to do is change the district handbook. Policy's at the 50,000 foot view. District handbook's at the 25,000 foot view, and the building management plans get to the granular level. So what we got here is the what we're looking at changing and making for our district handbook. Because it's a handbook, it doesn't happen till like April. And so I just wanted to inform you that, you know, we're not looking at changing the policy, but the handbook will probably see some changes with the dress code procedures. So this is for your review. Any questions or concerns regarding it, after you've read it through, please email me and I will share it with Ms. Miller and Ms. Dorr without violating any cross-communication, extra people talking. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
The way you worded that, it may change. Would the handbooks not change if this...
What's that?
The individual handbooks, would they not change?
I haven't looked at those yet. What we need to do is try and get the district handbook and then get the building management plans in line. So anything that's out of line or doesn't go with what this is representing would need to change. So yeah, the building management plans need to follow the district handbook and the district handbook needs to follow the policy. So, like a Petrushka doll, like those little Russian dolls that fit inside of each other.
Other questions, comments? Thank you, Mr. Grody. Item number four is we need to approve the cooperative agreement with Elkville School District.
Yeah. The letter from Mr. Spain is coming around. We've been, I think, co-opted with them for 2 years now. Has it been 2 years or has it been more than that?
Sounds about right.
It's a 2 year. So basically what we do is I'm going to recommend that we approve it. It's been good for all people, both sides. I will say that it then still has to go to the IHSA board to see if they approve it.
It's good for the kids.
It is.
It's good for the kids.
So the recommendation is to approve the co-op agreement with the high school football with Alvarado.
Any questions? Entertain a motion.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries. We need to go into closed session.
I can make a motion to go into closed session pursuant to Section 2 of the Open Meetings Act 5, Illinois Compiled Act 2020/2C to review the appointment, employment, compensation,
guys, we're not in closed session yet. Not adjourned.
Including hearing testimony on a complaint lodged against an employee to determine its validity. And two, a student disciplinary case.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a second. Nancy?
Mr. Beavers?
Yes.
Mr. Green?
Yes.
Mrs. James?
Yes.
Mrs. Miller?
Yes.
Dr. Corley?
Yes.
Mrs. Dorr?
Yes.
Mr. Rungy?
Yes. Motion carries.